So let me begin by asking each of you. We have a dual problem of availability and quality of water. How severe is the water crisis in India today? Mr. Jha, maybe you can start.
What water crisis? There is abundance of water on the earth. I think there is more water than land. So the problem is really water, or the problem is potable water? If the problem is potable water, there is, with global warming, that problem should have been also solved, because one thing we know for sure is to boil the oceans, we need more heat, and global warming is very helpful that way, and we should be having even more water. Our problem seems to be coming from somewhere else. We are not able to apparently manage the water in a manner that when it flows down, where it flows down, we cannot predict it. We do not know how to harness it. We do not know how to store it. And even if we were able to convert water from the saline water, it will require more energy, which if it comes from fossil fuel, which will mean 1.5% carbon, if it goes up, the water crisis will go up by 50%. Now that is the size of the problem, because there are 2 billion people in the world who are apparently under water distress. There are 600 million people in India who are actively under water distress as of now. And all this is happening because we have not been able to crack the problem of how to harness the water that is already available and allow it to keep on going into the cycle of from the sky to the earth, back to the water bodies and back to the sky. And we do not know how to manage it in between. I think that is the crisis that we are really dealing about. And we call ourselves a technologically advanced world. I do not know that if this was a problem of the ancient world at all, or is it a problem of our making from the advanced world. And where we have lost our way, we need to find our way through the same technology. That's what I would say is the real discussion that we should have.
Jha, you've had some massive success with your company in terms of water management. Take us through some of that steps.
Thank you for that question, because Ambuja Cements is actually 6.2 times water positive as of now. And in 2012, it became 2 times water positive. By 14, it was 4 times water positive, and it is 6.2 times now. But if I look at my own company, there are 2 plants, one in Rajasthan and one in Gujarat. Both are water scarce states. That is where I have got one plant which operates with 17 times water positive, 17.7 in fact. The other one in Kodinar district in Gujarat is 12.9 times water positive. Now, why is it that the ones where there is water scarcity, they are more water positive? Because when I'm saying 6.2 times and I'm feeling proud about it, it is like my head is in the oven and feet in the ice. On an average, my body temperature is normal. Because 6.2 times with 2 plants having more than 10 times water positive means I have got plants which are at 1.5 times, 2.5 times water positive. And where are they? They are in the areas where there is high rainfall. Which means that there is something about an attitude of the people about using water. It's about seeing abundance and not caring about it. So we have systematically tried to build programs and sensitize people. And I must confess one thing, that we as leaders who are sitting at the top of the corporate echelon today, unfortunately, we are responsible for a lot of our problems. Because when we were in schools, water and waste were not the subjects. Actually, these are the subjects which our children are talking about. And we do need some amount of reverse mentoring from them. But nevertheless, in Ambuja, fortunately, the founders were having enough vision to start 25 years ago, and the will persistence has shown something very positive that can be done. We had 15 kilometers of salinity into the ground from the sea in Kodinar district. and with check dams and interlinking, we have been able to push it back by almost 7 to 8 kilometers. And this is all measured data by the government, etc. So there are technologies which are known. Micro irrigation is known, which we are of course doing through our Ambuja Cement Foundation. We are helping people to understand how to use less water and produce better crops, and therefore the crop yield with the farmers wherever our plants are. We work in that area with our Ambuja Cement Foundation, and everybody gets 2 to 3 times crop yield using lesser water. There have been a lot of self-help groups which have been able to now put a lot more water harvesting in place. And rainwater harvesting, unfortunately, a lot of people who do not understand the technology, they end up putting water into the ground, which if it doesn't go to the aquifers, then it simply evaporates back into the air if they are not stored somewhere. And these are things that need to be known. There are people sometimes just do these kind of things without thinking what are the consequences. If there are gypsum layers somewhere below the ground, you're not going to get the water penetration down. So you need to know the technology. You need to know the techniques that allow you to recharge the aquifers and not with the bad quality of water and then treat it again, like the case in Mumbai, etc. So what we have experienced in Ambuja Cement is that there is a science behind this whole water harvesting and making sure that there are visible results for the communities that we serve. And these visible results are the ones which we are willing to share and expand with the help of anybody who is wanting to cooperate with Ambuja Cement Foundation. Please bring in your projects, and we will go not just to the areas where our operations are, but we can go to new projects and new areas. And there are other people, I'm sure, that who are entrepreneurs, who are you are into waste management. All these things can come together, but one thing that needs to really, really change is regulation. And on the regulation front, I must say that my own father-in-law retired as a chairman of Central Water Commission, and he had shown me that how they have developed the entire river interlinkage program. Here there are politicians who are fighting elections on not allowing one state to give the water to another state, but there is already program available with the government to interlink the rivers, even make these rivers navigable, and after the railways, this would be the next big thing in transportation. It will make so much of difference to the country, both through political will and regulation. What we have shown is that will persistence pays, and the experiment in Kodinar district is not just one example. We have got other examples, and this will persistence is what is also needed at the regulation level.
How do we, sort out this severe mess that we've built ourselves, the water crisis that we have?
There are two categories in which I would divide this issue of how do we go forward from here. Number one is acting on the tested hypothesis. There are already known technologies, known methodologies, known things. Maybe a bit of regulation around that should help us to adapt quickly and make it almost compulsory for things which are sustainable so that everybody uses it. So it's not the lack of knowledge, it's just the lack of application, and we need to deal with that lack of application either through awareness and self-initiative. But if people can't show self-initiative, there has to be regulation. So that's one way to one part to deal with it. But as you rightly said, that there is a greater problem of sensitivity, of understanding that this is an important subject. I wouldn't be averse to an idea of actually having the board committees which are constituted of people below 30 years of age who are sitting on those board committees on sustainability, on water usage, on waste usage, etc. And their recommendations could be binding on the companies, because here is the role for reverse mentoring of the generation which has been completely insensitive in its younger growing years to this development that has become a necessity to understand that we are actually borrowing from our children and we are not leaving enough for them. And therefore it is important to do something about that. And finally, there is also a role for innovation and technology that needs to improve things. For example, there is no reason why the water that I use for washing my hand should not be the water that is used for flushing. The problem is, how do you store it without the bacterial growth taking place over there? And how does it become an integral element of the complete system design at an individual house level, at companies level, at municipal level, etc.? Now, this sort of water, which needs very little treatment, but can be utilized either for irrigation or for the purpose of flushing, etc., we need to start becoming sensitive to that and make these micro technologies available, do some amount of research funding, give some amount of innovation awards, let people come up with billions of ideas with billions of people, and I'm sure that we can find our way out of this crisis. It is not something that is undoable, it is just that will persistence, as I said earlier, is what is required.
Can the economy and nature grow hand in hand? And can sustainability affect profits in the long run?
This is a very interesting question, because a lot of people do believe that it costs you money to be sustainable. I think we tend to forget some basic lessons. We think that win-lose is an option, and we know that it deteriorates into lose-lose. And so most people have come to understand that win-win is the only option. Unfortunately, what we have forgotten to take a lesson is that win-win is a collusive relationship. It is an incomplete concept. And if you want to see the proof, look at the whole world's industry since Industrial Revolution and the whole world's consumers, how well they have colluded into a win-win relationship, getting cheap goods, cheap products, and consumerism. Everything has happened. We call it even prosperity. And then there is a third win which we forgot about, and it came back to us in the form of global warming. And win-win-lose has begun to deteriorate into a lose-lose-lose. Discovering this third win is an integral element of our equation. That is an integral element of our long-term sustainability. But even on the more basic direct financial numbers, I can tell you that when Ambuja uses less water, it produces less resources that are required to be maintained. And therefore, it is more economic from our point of view. It is more sustainable from the society that grows around us, and therefore does not put pressure on us for jobs, which we cannot give beyond a point. But they are more economical by having better crop yield using micro irrigation there. We need to understand this third win a little better. And I can tell you, in answer to the previous question as well, anybody needing advice on rainwater harvesting, it is available free from Ambuja. You want more technical help, it is also available from us. And we have certified engineers who are not our employees. And we can give you the names of those people, and any society, housing society or an individual house builder wants to do something, they are available to you and you can get the names from us. From our point of view, we see it as a sustainable business idea simply because there are so many contractors whom we have trained who are positively disposed towards us. They get business not just for rainwater harvesting. They also do business for cement. I think it is a win-win relationship, but it is in a win-win-win format and not in a collusive win-win format.
I'm asking the panel, is there a procedure where we can sustain this overflowing of the rivers during the rainy season and store it in various other channels so that during the lean period we can utilize that overflowing rivers for our better use?
As far as my knowledge goes, there is a completely developed plan with the Central Water Commission to interlink the rivers and not have this crisis. It is just to dust the files and implement.
Last week, I had a discussion with one of the CWC people. they were having the divergence view. One is pro and one is against.
That's the problem.
So thank you so much, gentlemen, for joining me, and thank you, audience. We hope you had a good session.